Welcome back to Rush Hour. My name is Mubarak Mugabo. We are still within the big issue and we are discussing the tea industry. We saw 9 factories closing down, and that means things are not going on well in that industry. Loss of jobs and certainly loss of money for the government. My guests in studio are Rukura Nicholas from Toro and Mitiana Company, Swaz Tea Company. We are represented by Victoria Shaba and Robert Ejiku from Uganda Tea Development Agency Limited. Before we took a short break, we wanted to look at, of course, the interventions that can as well be made. But before we get even to that, how much impact? Because we know, of course, there are factories that have already closed. Let's first take a look at how much impact is it on those which are still surviving. Let me start with you, Nicholas. What have you been able to do before you even call for further interventions from other stakeholders?
Thank you so much. We at the Toro and Mitiana Tea Company, when we faced this crisis, the first thing that we had to see was to cut all our costs. And among the costs that we decided to cut was to downsize our labor, because labor is very key in every aspect of production. And remember, if you don't meet the demands of labor, then you're bound to get a lot of problems. Remember, these workers, you have to feed them, you have to pay them the salaries, you have to cater for them the medical, you have to cater for every injury that comes to them. So there are so many things that you have to cater for these workers. So for you to survive this, we had to downsize. We understand the impact that is now going on to those who have lost their jobs. Of course, it was not our intention, and we don't intend to do that. But we are left with no choice rather than
cutting downsizing. Is it the same case, Robert, with your company?
Yes, yes, it's the same case. You know, the first culprit always is the worker. They become an expense. At first, you look at them as an asset to the company, and then they become an expense thereafter when you're faced with such a situation. So there's been downsizing workers, and the businesses have also been downsized. Some factories, some of those that have closed. If you are having 2 factories, you now operate 1, which means you've cut the volumes that you're going to be handling to about what 1 can handle. And that's happening around in this country. Now, what else have we been able to do? Now, you look at the main thing you're trying to attack here in this crisis is that cash flows have gone down. You want your costs also to come down. Because the cost of production is what you're trying to work towards. And if it's at 1.2, then you're getting 60, 70 cents. You're not going to break even at all. So you must try and bring those costs down while working on the other end to get the prices up. A number of factories, by the way, I will tell you, a number of factories are working on their quality of their tea, and they're beginning to see results.
Rather than quantities?
But quantities are important later, but right now what needs to be addressed first is quality. For whatever quantities you're getting, address the quality. So a number of factories are working on quality. They're beginning to see a few cents come on top of that. But there is a bigger problem, as we said, that relates to quality than they can handle single-handedly. To go the full mile, they will eventually need fertilizers as you come into the season. And these fertilizers, if they're expensive, then you are going to raise your cost of production. So you don't need to go into that rat race.
Absolutely.
So just to finish this, the other thing that we need to do is efficiency. Okay? You look at efficiency in all aspects. How are you utilizing your power, for instance? Are you using your power efficiently? Are you using it during the peak or during the shoulder? Are you processing during the peak or during the shoulder?
Those remedies that certainly people or in the industry actually need to be done. But Victoria, before we get to that, you mostly deal with the small scale farmers and certainly factories down there on the ground. Yes. How much impact has it been? And for example, people who would be bringing, outgrowers who have been bringing tea what is happening in that direction?
It's an absolute mess. We are stuck between a rock and a hard place.
Mm.
We have farmers who have been consistently and loyal bringing tea to the factory. So you find that you're in a position where you cannot afford to pay them because you do not have the capital to manage that. Yet again, you need the tea to continue processing. If you ask them to say pause and not bring tea to you, they will eventually find someone else they're going to give the tea to. So it's a thing of trying to balance while struggling. We are truly, truly under the water. I can't even imagine what is happening elsewhere with the people like Chamuhunga Tea, who are also smaller. You know, there are others that have closed, like Nyambia, because of issues like these. But like my brother, Robert, said, we are trying to focus more on quality. We keep the farmers working, busy, but emphasizing on the quality so that we can, in the end, also improve the price that we're able to fetch at the auction, since it is our main.
I saw your area member of parliament saying that it is time now to advise farmers to uproot these trees.
It's more expensive.
Have you gotten to that level?
Well, it's counterproductive. Yeah. It's counterproductive to be doing that. I think government from about 2001 invested a lot in the tea sector in terms of providing planting materials. These clonal teas that we're talking about, government has been providing from about that time up to today. So to say that all this investment, we have figures from NADS, I think 700 or thereabouts billion invested over the years. All these investments will now just go to waste and we uproot the teas. I think it is counterproductive for this country and for the sector.
Now, you've been actually talking about interventions before you even get into the government, what other stakeholders can do within the factories. What exactly should those factories, in the circumstances, if nothing is done, what should they do?
But I think we're just going to be repeating ourselves, but three things broadly. One is reducing costs. Of course, reducing the farmer's price is one of those costs, but you must be able to understand the farmer's cost of production. You can't just reduce the cost of leaf to say, I can only afford 150 when the farmer's cost of production is 250. This is going to be the first farmer to uproot that tea. So, but there are other costs. No, you try and fit your labor to what you actually need, and you cut on the labor costs. You cut on other costs. Maybe you had costs, overhead costs that you could do without in the meantime, in this kind of time. What we normally refer to as austerity measures. You take serious austerity measures to ensure that you fit within the cloth that you have available. Okay? So, cost reduction is one. The number two thing which saves you money a lot is efficiency in everything. If you're maintaining your machines, for instance, well, because you planned ahead of time and got in spares that could last you 6 months during this crisis, you have spares to maintain your machinery. Your downtime when the machinery is not working and losing money and time is going to be so low, and you're going to be more efficient and save much more money. I've talked about electricity, energy. These are elements of efficiency. Now in the sector, we use a lot of firewood, for instance. Now, if I'm going to cut firewood, we mainly use eucalyptus. If I'm going to cut eucalyptus firewood today and put it in my boilers, I am going to generate so little energy out of that wet firewood than if I had harvested that and had it in my yard for 6 months and it is totally dry. I will get the real calorific value of that firewood. Those are elements of efficiency. How we can utilize the resources that we have efficiently. And I know most, if not all, the factories have done that so that they can save the farmer. And that is not helping, because the prices continue to stay down there or even keep going down further. The third thing, which is at a broad level, is the question of quality.
Yes.
Because now you're beginning to attack the price.
Yes.
You want to improve the price. Because as I said, there is a lot of demand for good quality tea. So unless we say, let's just continue producing what we're producing and hope that Sudan eventually will come back into the market and take this quality of teas that we produce. Or some Pakistani buyers will get more dollars and begin to take some of this quality of teas that we're taking. Because eventually, if it's lower quality of tea, it still has a market. It will be bought. It's used as what they call a price reducer. Because tea, black tea all over the world is taken as a blend. So when tea is bought in Mombasa and the auctions, it's taken to Pakistan, it goes into a blending and packing house. So once they blend all these different, what we call gardens, in that blend, then they will package it as tea bags or as loose tea in those small packets and then send it around the world.
Absolutely.
And you know, we get them here as well in Uganda and so on.
And yet actually it is so produced forth. Here.
Yes.
Anyway, Nicholas, what interventions are you suggesting for... To rescue the situation in this area?
Actually, we are looking at various interventions, although sometime back we had some engagements with the government, which maybe I will explain later about that. But
no, you can actually explain it.
Okay, anyway. So when we were faced with this crisis, we sat down as Uganda Tea Association and we said, what can we do to ensure that we don't reach where we have reached right now? And that's where my blame goes to the government, because we are alarmed to the government long ago. It's very unfortunate. But we had proposed so many interventions, but right now we looked at the short-term interventions. And I happen to have been one of the teams with Robert and Victoria here, where we had to bring this to the attention of the president.
Okay.
Because we had to write to the president, and good enough, the president had to direct the prime minister to meet Uganda Tea Association members and see what was going on. And the prime minister, that was back in November on 2nd, we managed to meet her. We expressed our concern, and the prime minister selected a committee, which was chaired by the minister of local government, that is Honorable Rafael Majezi, to go down and arrange ourselves so that we can be in position to streamline everything. Because the Prime Minister was hitting out that most of the questions which we were hitting at her, they were for various ministries. And by the time we met her, the ministers were not around. So she was like, at least if you can go back and organize yourselves, and we structure each and every question to different ministries. So she invites those ministers to come and attend that meeting, which we agreed. We went and they sat down, and we came back. That was on 4th of November when we met with
last
them.
Year.
Yeah, last year with all the ministers. So we presented, that was the chairman of UTA, Mr. Mugabe, who presented. After presenting, then the prime minister was like, they will prepare a cabinet paper, which they will have to present before the cabinet. But among our interventions that we are asking from the government, we were talking of the quality. We said our quality is hit so much by lack of fertilizer application. And that's when we said, if the government can at least, we know government has also other problems from other sectors. We said at least if they can cut fertilizers, at least 50% subsidy, so that if the government can contribute to us 50%, and then we also contribute 50% to it, then we can at least be in position also to apply fertilizers. We also looked at cutting the cost of electricity, at least also by 50%. I think Robert,
is that possible in the circumstances?
Because yeah, it looks weird, but we had no any alternative. And that's what we were pleading to the government to look through. So I think Robert will tell you in terms of figures. So we also asked the government if they can at least reduce the cost of fuel by 50% too. The 50% we cater for it. And by then we are seeing this coming. We asked for a stabilization fund, that if the government can come up with a stabilization fund so that these factories, and by the way, these factories which have closed, you never know, they wouldn't have closed if we had got that stabilization fund. So there are so many, which I would not exhaust here, but those were the key. At least fertilizers, the stabilization fund, because that's what we stuck on. Mm-hmm. But up to now, ever since we met with the Prime Minister promised what she promised. Mm-hmm. Although other subsequent meetings were going on, although as UTA we have never as in coming back, that to say this is an official communication that is coming back from what we discussed. So we are just here, and what we predicted has now come to light.
Victoria, what are your thoughts about these interventions, and what more can government do to ensure that this issue is resolved?
First of all, I don't think there's any other way unless we get money to actually get this done. There are a lot of capital requirements to run the business, and the only way we can manage is, most importantly, through that stabilization fund. The fertilizer, just to increase, just to expound on it, not only does it improve the quality, but also the productivity. We also need to be able, as farmers, for example, us and then Tamteko and UTDA, we also need to come together as a team to create more awareness with the help of government about the consumption of tea. The
in
tea
Uganda.
Within our own country. The tea here, the one that we process as a country, if, for example, if we are almost 50 million, if we all consumed every day about 3 cups of tea, we would consume
only
two to three cups.
Yeah, only two.
We could consume the entire lot of tea, and we don't have to deal with all these other markets that are putting all these stringent. So I think it's more
also
awareness.
You're also calling
awareness.
For like the company to teach Ugandans how to drink tea. But actually
need,
for us, we know.
I don't think you do, because if you did, you would not buy the imported teas.
Oh, maybe talking about Bubu. Is it called Bubu?
Buy Uganda, build Uganda. Yes.
Maybe that would be certainly a better one. Because for tea, Victoria, we take tea.
You take tea, but you're not taking Ugandan tea.
Absolutely. Yes. What are your thoughts?
Let me just start on that. It's actually interesting. You see, even if we're buying non-Ugandan teas that come in here, as long as it's a black tea that which we produce, some of our tea is in those packs. For instance, Ketepa packs, you see them in the supermarkets. Those are packed by a subsidiary of KTDA. Ketepa, in Kericho here, and that tea is now plenty in Uganda. But they buy a lot of our teas through chai trading in Mombasa, which goes into these blends. And you have Kericho Gold here.
Yes.
In most of our supermarkets. Actually, it might overtake Ketepa in terms of market share at the rate at which they are going. They are a very organized group. The Crown Food, food and beverages in Mombasa. They are a blending and a packing company. They buy their tea through Global Tea Commodities, GTC in Mombasa. So, and they buy a lot of our teas as well. So if we continue to consume some of those products are not our own, then we're still contributing indirectly to improving on the market's condition. So the only key thing is, are we really actually buying those teas? But maybe not, because the amount of tea we're able to sell in the local market is so low, less than 5%, that I don't think we are actually consuming a lot of that tea. So whether I need to go out and teach people how to drink tea or to go out there and promote tea in a different way, it for itself benefits for all the other good things about tea, its contribution to the economy. That's for us to discuss. Now, we've talked about interventions. Let me just get to the interventions Nicholas and Victoria have alluded to. There are those immediate interventions just to ensure that the industry doesn't, the sector doesn't collapse. The tea factories don't close the way they are doing. When we talk about fertilizer subsidy, we're not looking at a long-term stay by government in this sector providing subsidies of 50%. You're looking at if you provide the subsidies for the next 1 year, because we think this problem can be reversed.
It's like a depression.
Mm. We've had these before. This has been the longest. And the prices that we're fetching now have been the lowest ever in this sector. So So you need subsidy maybe for a year, maybe two. But I think our discussions within the sector were, if we had subsidies for a year, then we begin to look at the, how can we make fertilizer supply in Uganda more sustainable?
Yeah.
We bring in people who can process these fertilizers from here. Mm. There's a company that established itself in China, and Chinese company Dong something in Tororo. They have a plant that can actually process fertilizers that we use, but they have never processed a bag. But they said, if we look at the your formulations here, we can get a bag to as low as 100,000 shillings. He told you 2019, 2018, a bag of fertilizer was 85,000 in 2018, just as recent as 2018, 6 years ago. Today it's 245. Okay? So if we have Dong Fang or whatever producing fertilizer there, the president is known to have written a letter to the prime minister asking them to provide land for another bigger company. Owned by a Burundian called Adrian Ndagachika, who has set up a huge plant in Tanzania, in Dodoma. So say, please provide them land so that they can establish a plant here. But that is for the future.
For the future, long
for
term.
For the future, long term, so but that the price can come. Immediate,
yes,
the subsidy. The subsidy is not a new thing. It has been provided elsewhere before.
Even to
there
others,
was a project, SDP, that provided
and even
subsidy.
Foreign producers.
Exactly.
Foreign factories.
So it's not a new thing. Every country does that when they are faced with this kind of challenge. That's number one. Number two, he talked of the stabilization fund. And the stabilization fund really basically is trying to address the issues of working capital.
Yeah.
The factories right now are facing working capital challenges. And why don't you go to the bank to pick that working capital? The banks don't give money on the strength of assets that you have, and particularly fixed assets. No. You might be an investment that is over 40 billion and you want only 1 billion. The bank won't give you money. It gives you money on the basis of one item on the balance sheet called cash. Now, if cash flows are poor, the banks are going to be so risk averse with this sector. Right now, that's what happens. You ask the banks without mentioning any company. Companies are falling back on their loan repayments.
Let's wind up this
and
conversation.
That's a problem.
I have not heard you talking about value addition in your industry.
That's what we were coming to. if you may allow
yes,
me,
please.
As a
please,
wind
let's
up
wind up with that value addition.
Yeah, value addition actually is beneficial in so many ways. One, you retain most of the value of within that value chain within your country. You create more employment and so on and so forth. Because you see, the person who sells that tea, say in UK, in Sainsbury store or in Waitrose store, is going to benefit from about 10 times the value we're getting as farmers. That 150, even put it at 500 shillings that the farmer was getting. The other one is going to get 10 times more. Because that kilo of tea in Sainsbury will be costing 50 to 90,000 shillings. That kilo of tea that they take there, depending on the blend and what type it is that they are putting on the supermarket shelves. So when we do value addition here, we retain that value here. And once we retain that value here, we can afford to determine how much we pay
absolutely
for our own products if they're coming from here.
Absolutely.
But it is an interesting and structured market, so we need to be very careful when we're doing that. But another more long-term thing is, what is our development strategy for tea in this country? If it is contained in a policy somewhere, do we have that policy? We don't.
We need
to go to the next level. Our problems are now also partially because, well, not partially, I would even say probably if we were always producing the type of teas we produced in the 90s, because they were fetching as much as the Rwanda and Kenya teas were fetching in the 90s, we wouldn't be where we are right now. We would have grown probably 3, 4, 5 fold. But our quality has been going down. How can we bring this into some level of stability and we begin seeing the quality go up? Regulation.
Absolutely. Your parting shots, Nicholas, Victoria, and then later on.
Yeah. Like we say, please, I'm not going to talk about value addition because right now,
can't talk about it when actually you're even still suffering with just
when
a
you're
few
still
issues.
Suffering with this, because to me, my point is stabilization fund, because if we don't really go by that, then we are bound, even us who are still standing, to go down. To go down. Yeah. Some of us who are still standing, they may say we are just pretending. We are just pretending because things are worse. When you look at the issues that we are supposed to counteract, and I'm actually, this is an appeal to all agencies, government agencies, and these other private sector players, because they need to understand us, the situation we are in. When you look at the banks, he has talked about the banks. We have NSSF. They are also demanding. We are having these people who have been supplying us with a green leaf. We are having fuel suppliers. Some of us who had tried to buy fertilizers at a very high cost, but are on credit, they are also demanding. We have these one people. And another thing is power, electricity.
Yeah, which is in the control of government.
Because without electricity, the factory can't run.
Absolutely. Victoria, your parting shots.
My parting shots. First of all, I am born and bred tea. Tea paid my school fees. So tea is everything that I know from childhood. I am second generation tea, and there are so many of us. We now even have children who are supposed to continue and take on the legacy. But in a place like this, or in a situation like this, where everything is a bit uncertain, we are crying, mayday, mayday. Our ship is sinking. We need help very fast. I want to encourage all the farmers out there and all the processors who are still working and all the potential investors. As much as there's a bit of a problem, I would like to also encourage you that there is still a lot of potential within our industry.
Absolutely.
And at such times when there is a crisis is where we come together to restructure from the ground up. So I want to encourage you, not all hope is lost. I thank the Honorable Prime Minister for taking charge and making this a very important issue that now even all the other government agencies and ministers and MPs are paying attention. I also want to thank the President of His Excellency, the President of our very beautiful nation, for finally looking on our side and knowing that there's a problem in our house and it's time to make a few changes.
Robert.
we have lots of partners that we work with. The banks, we have Uganda Revenue Authority, and if these guys come hard on to us in the tea sector, that's how quickly we are going to be closing. So I'm looking at a situation where, for instance, banks must be able to restructure facilities that the tea sector players have had with them. I'm looking at a situation where URA gives a little bit of reprieve in saying, okay, you all have arrears, but we're going to give you maybe very, very little installments to keep paying as we wait for this to happen. I know they need the money. They need the money. Even what we're asking for, we're now asking other sectors to contribute towards this sector so that we will be able to contribute again. I think it is something that we need to do together.
Unfortunately,
and the government has a big role to play in this. Thank you.
We have run out of time. Thank you so much, Robert. Thank you so much, Victoria. Thank you so much, Nicholas. But I think also you need to ensure that your association is getting vibrant each day, because I think the message needs to get to the policymakers and to people out there. But also government can as well encourage government agencies, instead of buying sodas, they should instead put tea in these offices. This actually has been done in many countries, and it has been able to improve farmers. Exactly. And this has been done, and it can be done in this country. Anyway, let's take a short break. When we return, we want to look at, of course, the Rush Talk, Maizu Ramiti and the team. Good morning.